as an international law expert, how would you like to convince a promising young professional to study international law? And what is special in dealing with these special issues?
Okay, well, that's the only thing I can talk about. It's only my own motivation, because I'm not the kind of person that likes to convince other people. But I can tell why I think international law is a fascinating field. That's for a number of reasons. One is that it is a field that, of course, deals with the big problems of the world, environmental degradation, human rights issues, peace and security, what have you, economic poverty, all these kinds of issues. International law touches upon it. So from a very practical perspective, it's an interesting field, but also from an historical perspective, it's a field that reflects the different ways in which we have been thinking about justice. So we're completely different conceptions of international law just 100 years ago than that we have now. So it reflects different understandings of what actually an international society is and is about. And thirdly, we are at a stage now in international law where we see very fascinating transformations, new forms of rulemaking, new kind of actors popping up in an attempt to deal with these big world problems that we started out with. So if you're interested either practically or intellectually or socially, international law is the place to go to. At least that's what I think.
New actors, could you be specific about that? What is interesting, what is new in the situations that you are dealing with?
Well, new actors, one of the actors that I study myself are the expert committees that are helping to produce international law. So one of the things that I'm also going to study here at the center is how in the field of counterterrorism, Security Council adopts resolutions, but if you read the resolution, you still do not really know what they mean. Then there is an expert committee that starts to further interpret and restate the Security Council resolution. It refers to yet another expert committee, it refers to yet another expert committee, and then it goes back to the Security Council and says, yes, that's what we meant. So this is one actor that is, of course, relevant. The other ones in my substantive field of specialization, the laws of armed conflict, international criminal law, are all kinds of non-state actors entering the stage of war. That's not completely new, of course, but the scale in which this happens now and interstate wars having become the exception rather than the rule, that of course changes the whole field of international law if it tries to regulate this.
What motivated you to make contact with the center and to think about approaching this field of global cooperation research?
Well, different reasons. One of them, of course, is very selfish, namely that I could buy myself out and do research, which in modern universities is not always a given. Secondly, that I knew that interesting work was being conducted here on specifically on narration and the role of emotions, which links up to some of the research that I'm doing. And what is attractive, of course, is that you A, get a buyout to do research, and B, they get to do research with a team of other people with whom you can communicate, get new ideas, test out new ideas. So that were the main reasons, and to improve my journey. Yeah, so there are a few points, I think, that make documentaries interesting from the legal perspective. One is the very fact that the International Criminal Court is legitimized through documentary films. Now, I cannot imagine any domestic criminal court that has to justify that people get punished. Right, so that's very specific of the international realm, that courts have to start by justifying that they exist to begin with. So that's one thing. The second thing which is interesting to me is the educational purpose, because I think international criminal law, just like domestic law, is not very successful in deterrence. I mean, the number of cases is so small. If you compare the number of cases to the number of dissertations, that's a huge mismatch. But what it can do is send out more general message. That certain forms of politics are perverse, are not normal, are not acceptable. But that means it's an educational enterprise. It's trying to teach something. Well, that's exactly what happens in documentary films. The term documentaries comes from Latin, docere, docere, is about to teach, to educate. And the way in which it is done is also, I think, interesting in terms of similarity, because international criminal law tells big stories about justice, but does it through the prism of an individual, the defendant. So formally the question is about the guilt or innocence of this defendant, but it's used to tell a bigger story. And that's also a way of narration that you find in a lot of documentary films. You use an individual to talk about bigger structural societal issues. So I think there are several similarities there. There's also differences, of course. So if it comes to the practices, how to establish truth, documentary film is way different from legal proceedings, right? So what counts as a truthful representation in documentary film does not necessarily count as a truthful representation in a court proceeding. So it's not that they're exactly the same, but there are some structural similarities that triggered my interest, and especially in the form of narration that I'm most interested in.
You've heard about the documentations, the four documentations that you've analyzed for the ICC, and the central argument of all those documentations is sort of westernized, Western perspective on international law. And I was wondering, if we look at sub-Saharan Africa, where there's this huge debate about also opting out of the Rome Statute, wouldn't it be important from a normative perspective of bringing the ICC or international justice on a global scale to also incorporate voices of sub-Saharan Africa and critical voices into those documentations that to me seemed kind of directed at an audience on NGO festivals, people who are convinced of the important role of international criminal law, while the stage where the ICC often operates, sub-Saharan Africa, is not really addressed in those documentaries. Do you think there's a normative role that could be changed by the filmmakers?
Well, I think it is very important to hear those voices. By definition, the Western filmmakers cannot change it because they do what they still do. So it's more to be receptive of what goes on in countries outside of the West. And also to hear the plurality of the voices in different African states, because it's not like all states want to get out of the ICC statutes, and even within states you have huge divides. Think of South Africa. So it's also to hear the different voices, but of course it matters where you are, what global justice means. And I think this is not just something that documentary makers should take into account. I think it's also for academics. So almost all the conferences on international criminal justice are in the West, whereas you would expect a conference to be sometimes in Sierra Leone or in Sudan or in Uganda or what have you, because those are the target countries. So I think it's broader than just a documentary film problem. So yes, absolutely, this is crucial that this happens. Yeah. Okay, so the project that I'm going to carry out here is about the way in which international law is repeated, restated in different forms. So I'm interested in practices, but I think international law as a field is made up by the way in which it reproduces itself. So what I'm interested in is in the field, for example, of customary law, looking at the way in which customary law is formed by the way in which it's restated by expert committees. Or I want to look at the Security Council, where every Security Council resolution starts by excessive recalling, reiterating, recognizing. So constant referral to itself. So presenting anew what they did before. So a narrative about the linkage of the past and the present. So that's another way in which international law is presented anew or reappropriated anew. So there's different practices I want to look at. The other one being academic articles that are restated in their abstracts, which is a relatively new phenomenon, especially in international law. But now, if you look at an article, we have an image of what an article looks like. You have a title, the name, and then an abstract. But it was nothing like that in some journals just a few years ago. So what does that signify about the field? And then look at what we do at law schools, in moot courts, where we teach students what it is to be a lawyer through moot court competitions. And I delve on theatre history and the history of rehearsals in Western theatre to try to make sense of how law is reproduced in those moot courts. So that's my plan for here. I have the rough material, but I'm really, really happy to now have the time to work on all this.
Okay, Walter, we thank you very much and
okay.
We wish you success.
Thank you. Really looking forward to the video. I have no clue what I said.